Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Well, good morning, church family, and welcome to worship on this absolutely beautiful Sunday morning. We're so glad that you've chosen to join us in worship this morning, no matter if this is your first time with us or you're a regular attender or you're joining us online today. We do appreciate your presence here with us. We do ask a couple of things of you. There are pew pads that are going to be passed out in just a few moments, and when our ushers pass that to you, if you wouldn't mind taking just a moment and filling it out and pass it back down the row. And that way you can see and greet those who are seated around you. Also in your order of service, you'll find a connection card. It's the tear-off portion of that, of the bulletin. And I hope that you'll take advantage and let us know of any prayer concerns that you might have. Your church staff goes through these every Tuesday and prays for those. And so I hope that you'll let us know of any prayer concerns that you have on your heart. By way of announcements, I do want to draw your attention to our church family news. This is a great way for you to keep up with what all is going on in the life of the church. Hope that you'll look through that. I do want to draw your attention to just a few things. First up, our congregation's crafters ministry is hosting their spring sale, which will take place next Saturday from 9 to noon over in our fellowship hall. And so make sure you clear your calendars for that. That is always a wonderful day, and you can load up on your scrubbies and do your Mother's Day shopping and all those kind of things. And of course, as always, all proceeds goes towards helping our local ministry partners. Also next weekend in Sunday school, we're going to be starting a new exciting spring study, and we're going to be looking at the book of Hebrews. And so if you're interested in Bible study, we hope that you will join us. It should be about a 10 or 12 week study, and that will begin next Sunday morning. And I hope that you can participate and keep cultivating our faith lives. And also, if you're interested in possibly making our church your church home, we have a class for you. It's called Starting Point, and that will be next Sunday. And if you're interested in that, it'll be about 30 minutes following each of our worship services. And we promise not to keep you too long. And that way you can learn a little bit about us and us about you as well. And finally, not this week, but the next week will be, of course, spaghetti supper. But you can go ahead and put that on your calendar. And, of course, make your reservation on our church's website, TellicoChurch.com. Well, at this time, I invite you to take a deep breath and settle your hearts and your mind as we prepare our hearts for worship.
Please join me in the call to worship. This is the good news which we proclaim to you. Walk in the light of his love.
Live in the light of his teachings and heal mercy.
Come, let us worship the one who overcame death. Let us celebrate the triumph of our Lord. Amen.
The first reading this morning is Psalm 133 from the New International Version. How good and pleasant it is when God's people live together in unity. It is like precious oil poured on the head, running down on the beard, running down on Aaron's beard, down on the collar of his robe. It is as if the dew of Hermon were falling on Mount Zion. For there the Lord bestows his blessing, even life forevermore. The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
Well, as we gather together in prayer, we bring today both our joys and our petitions, and certainly a part of that is recognizing the beautiful flowers that you see today given by the Duncans, Scott and Suzanne celebrating their 6th wedding anniversary, as well as Deborah London celebrating her niece's birthday. The red rose that you see here is given remembering the life of Gary Howell, who passed away this past week. Just so you'll know, a celebration of life service for Becky Moore will take place this Wednesday, April the 10th at 11 a.m. Well, I invite you now to join me in a time of prayer. And as we do so, we certainly want to lift up those from our congregation who have been sick and in the hospital, as well as those who've lost loved ones. In particular, we want to lift up George and Linda Arwood and the death of their son, Jeffrey, who passed away unexpectedly this weekend. Also remember Karen Kessler, a wrestler who is recovering from surgery. Included in your order of service, you'll see in our people, in our prayers, prayers of the people, a listing of all of our known prayer concerns at this time. And I hope that you'll pray for them not only today, but in the days ahead as well. If you would, bow your head at this time and let us pray together. Our most gracious and kind Heavenly Father, our source of everything that we have and are. Lord, whom we look to not only as our ideal, but Lord, also our constant companion in life. And Lord, today when we cannot see beyond our daily routines, when the monotony of the days run together, and when our future, Lord, seems uncertain, and when we feel overwhelmed by situations that eat away at us, Lord, it's you. Lord, you shine through it all. And you remind us of your future in our lives, a future with hope, a future with life, an abundant and full life. Lord, today we pray for our church family. We pray for those who are on our congregation's prayer list. Lord, give them all, each person, each situation. Lord, give them all a unique sense of your love and protection as they walk down difficult paths today, Lord. Lord, we know that we live in a world that has fallen and there's so many hot spots all around the globe. And Lord, we lift up those who are in those places today. Lord, be with those who are in war-torn areas. Lord, where darkness seems to be the rule of the day. Lord, in those places, may your light shine. May those who need that special touch or glimpse today, Lord, may they have that. Lord, we also pray for our congregation, Lord, that we would always seek to be your hands and your feet to our community. Lord, we pray for each person here and all the different things that they're going through. Be with those who've lost loved ones. May they sense your presence with them this day. Be with all of our church family as we seek to be your people right here in our own community. Lord, we ask this and all of these things today in the name of the one who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Now let us continue in our worship through the giving of our tithes and our offerings.
Thank you. Let us pray. Holy God, we give you thanks and praise for light and life and love, and above all, the presence of the living Lord among us. By your Spirit who breathes within us, strengthen our faith. Use these gifts that we have given in this offering and in this week in our lives, and work in our lives so that we may bear witness to the resurrection of Christ our Lord, in whose name we now pray. Amen. You are invited now to remain standing and pass the peace of Christ with those around you as you feel comfortable.
Our second reading this morning is from 1 John chapter 1 and chapter 2, verse 2. That which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked at and our hands have touched, this we proclaim concerning the word of life. The life appeared, we have seen it and testify to it, and we proclaim to you the eternal life, which was with the Father and has appeared to us. We proclaim to you that what we have seen and heard, so that you may also have fellowship with us. And our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. We write this to make our joy complete. This is the message we have heard from him and declare to you. God is light. In him there is no darkness at all. If we claim to have fellowship with him and yet walk in the darkness, we lie and do not live out the truth. But if we walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his Son, purifies us from all sin. If we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just, and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. If we claim we have not sinned, we make him out to be a liar, and his word is not in us. My dear children, I write this to you so that you will not sin. But if anybody does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous one. He is the atoning sacrifice for our sins, and not only for ours, but also for the sins of the world. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. This past week, I got a call, and this call kind of derailed the rest of my week, kind of derailed even my preparation for the sermon, and probably will derail the rest of this week. Tuesday morning, before staff meeting, as I'm trying to get going after Easter, I get a call from my father-in-law, and he says, "Do you want to go to the Masters on Sunday next week?" So I said yes. I haven't been able to think of much else since then. And you know, if you want proof of the Lord on high. Several weeks ago, separate of me knowing anything about that, Steve said, hey, can we switch weeks? Because I was scheduled to preach next Sunday, and he was scheduled to preach this Sunday. And just kind of independent of that, he said, hey, let's switch. So the Lord is good. He has good plans for you. Plans for hope, plans to make you prosper. And so can I get an amen on that? You know, the Masters, it's something that I've wanted to do for quite some time. If you know me, I am a golfer, and I told Lauren, you know, I don't know what I'm more excited for, the birth of our kids or this. And I mean, kids, come on, they're with you for the rest of your life. How many times am I going to do this? She didn't like that. But as a golf fanatic, I can describe most of the course to you. I can describe these things about the course. I can tell you how, and if you're a sports fan, it'll end here in a few minutes, but I can tell you how the sand isn't really sand. I can tell you some pin locations that are tricky that will always be there on Sundays. I can tell you that you don't want to be short on hole 12, and that's kind of a make or break moment. But all these things are things that I know about the course, things that have been told to me, things that I've heard, things that I've understood and just trying to absorb knowledge. I mean, a quick Google search and you and I could know the same amount. You may know more about it than I do. But what you can't understand is what you haven't experienced. I haven't experienced that early morning dew on the course. I haven't experienced the smells coming through. I haven't experienced the brightness and the vividness of the flowers all throughout the course. I haven't experienced the undulation that you can't see on TV. I haven't experienced the atmosphere of when someone's making a charge on that. See, the difference in what I have is difference between knowledge and difference of experience. It's one thing to know about something. It's another to experience it. It's one thing to know about the Great Barrier Reef and the aquamarine life in there, the coral. It's another to dive deep into the waters and to see the fish swimming, to see those colors bright and pop right in front of you. It's one thing to know about the Rocky Mountains and the formation, to see pictures of them. It's another to stand at the base of them and look up and be lost in the grandeur of it all. It's one thing to have to say, hey, here's how I'm going to raise my kids. It's another thing to be in the throes of it, and you say, okay, all bets are off. We're just surviving. This difference between knowledge and experience, it plays out in all areas of our life, and it plays out in our faith, too. It's one thing to know about God. It's one thing to know about worship. It's one thing to know about why we gather. It's another to experience it. To experience his love, to experience his grace, to experience his mercy. Those are things that knowledge can't transform you. That difference, that delineation between faith known versus faith experienced is the essence of the Christian life. It's a definitive step in faith, moving from knowledge to experience. And we see that in the lives of the apostles. So if you have a Bible, we're going to take a little detour from where we just read. You can turn to John chapter 20. John chapter 20 is where I'm going to pick up real quick. And if you missed last week, let me recap what's going on there. Jesus was crucified and buried in the tomb on Friday. And because of the customs and ceremonies of practices, they didn't have enough time to prepare the body before the Sabbath. And on the Sabbath, they couldn't work. And so Jesus sat there. And so they come back, the women, on Sunday morning to prepare finally Jesus' body. So Mary Magdalene and some other women, they're going to the tomb and they find it empty. And Mary then is distraught. She's sitting there, we see, weeping because they don't know what happened to Christ's body. She thinks somebody might have come and taken him. But then she hears, Mary, peace be with you. She hears the words of her Savior. She hears the words of the resurrected one. And so she runs and goes and tells the other disciples and goes back. And John doesn't record this part. I think there's a reason why. Luke, who's the physician who takes an intricate amount of details in what he does and how he records the scriptures, Luke says that in Luke 24:11, the disciples did not believe the women because their words seemed like nonsense. If I was John, I wouldn't record that either. An interesting side note here, in Jewish court, you needed three witnesses to testify to the validity and have a valid claim. A particular note is those witnesses, if you wanted a valid claim, none of them should be women. That only a man's word would uphold in court. So there in Luke's gospel, he has three women come and testify to the resurrection of Christ. And it's a key piece of validity for the resurrection, because if you're Luke, if you're the disciples, if you're someone trying to make up this story of a resurrection, you don't go on the witness of three women whose claims would not be valid in any court. And Jesus, he says, just like the shepherds at my birth, he reveals himself to those whom people weren't paying much attention to. Anyways, after Mary shares the news of the resurrection to the disciples, Jesus then appears in that upper room. There in chapter 20, verse 19, we're probably familiar with that story. They're behind locked doors, the disciples being associated with Christ, who was just crucified, and the religious leaders may be coming after them. So they're sitting in that room, locked up, worried, like, what's going to happen to us? Where do we go? Our leader's gone. And Jesus does that great magic trick where he just walks through the door. And says, peace. Peace be upon you. Peace be with you. He shows them his hands. He shows them his side where he had the mortal wounds of the crucifixion. And the disciples see this, and it says they're mourning, their uncertainty. It's turned to joy. But there's one disciple that for unknown reasons wasn't there at that time. And so in chapter 20, verse 24, it says, now Thomas, also known as Didymus, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, we have seen the Lord. But he said to them, unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put my fingers where his nails were and put my hand into his side, I will not believe. See, Thomas missed out on Jesus appearing to the others. And here we see some of the disciples coming up to him and sharing that good news, saying, hey, Thomas, he did what he said he would. We didn't know what was going to happen, but he did it. He's alive. And Thomas is like, I can't comprehend that. Unless I put my fingers in his wounds, unless I see it with myself, unless I experience it, it doesn't do anything for me. See, Thomas, faced with that knowledge, says, it's not transforming. This is where he gets his namesake, being a doubting Thomas. I mean, wouldn't you love to be defined by your weakest moment? See, Thomas knows what's being told to him. He has his friends, he has his compadres, guys who he's locked arms with for the past 3 years of ministry, and they're telling him one thing, but it's not computing. We don't know the reasons for his doubt, but we do know that he has a hard time taking those disciples at their word. Thomas has the knowledge, but that knowledge can't transform him. He needs the experience. And sure enough, a week later, they're back in that upper room again, and Thomas is with them. And down in verse 27, Jesus comes through the doors locked again and says, peace be with you. Then he said to Thomas, put your finger here, see my hands, reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe. Thomas said to him, my Lord and my God. Then Jesus told him, because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed. Thomas sees. And that knowledge, it transforms into experience because he had an encounter with the resurrected Christ. And what's interesting about Thomas is if you read throughout the rest of the New Testament, you're not going to find him much. You'll find him in the book of Acts, mainly in a few lists of other disciples. But other than that, he's pretty MIA. Through all the journeys, through all the building of the church in Acts, through all the spreading of the gospel, Thomas isn't there. You know why? Because he was gone. He was far away. Thomas took the gospel further than any of the other apostles, any of the other disciples. Thomas was so impacted by his experience with the resurrected Savior that he took it literally to the ends of the earth as far as he could. He ventured out, as we know for the most part, as far as India, taking the gospel there, planting churches, planting communities that would then go and tell others of the resurrected Christ. Thomas spread the gospel eastward, all along the way, telling people of the man who changed his life, of the man who rose from the dead, of how he touched the wounds in his hands and in his side. Church tradition tells us that Thomas even went to the grave as a martyr, being speared to death in India, because he would not stop telling others about Christ. That knowledge transformed when he experienced the resurrected Savior. Nothing else would shut that down. If that was just knowledge, probably would have peaced out when that spear came out. But because he had experienced, because he had seen, because he had heard, because he had touched, he proclaimed in the face of suffering. And John, in his epistle that we read earlier, says, this is what we're to do with our lives as well. That which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our own eyes, which we have looked at and our hands have touched, this we proclaim concerning the word of life. Just as Thomas took the gospel to the ends of the earth, just as the multitude and the hundreds that saw the resurrected Christ, just as they took the gospel and spread it throughout the region, so too are we to take the gospel and spread it. Now, I'm not saying you're to hop on a plane right now and go to India. I mean, maybe God's calling you to that. If he is, let's pray with you and we'll send you, we'll go, and we'll keep in touch. But for the most part, he's probably telling you to go where you are. He's calling us to proclaim and to testify to his goodness in the places that he's already called you to. His goodness, which offers forgiveness for sins, which offers us a place in his kingdom, laying down our throne and our pride to have a seat in his kingdom at his table where he sits at the head. And where our worth isn't based upon hoping we've done enough good, but instead solely trusting in the blood of Christ shed on the cross. There's a lot of people here. There's a lot of people in the village. There's a lot of people in the surrounding communities. There's a lot of people in this church that don't know the forgiveness of our Savior, that have never experienced the resurrected Christ. And God invites you to be a part of telling that story to them, to your neighbor, to the random you get paired with on the course, to your waiter or waitress. You know, there's 7.9 billion people on this earth. There's no shortage of opportunities in sharing your faith with one another. Now, I know sharing your faith, that word evangelism, makes us feel a little weird inside. The easiest way I found to do that is simply asking somebody, hey, how can I pray for you? Or maybe it's saying just a simple statement with a question, do you know God loves you? And just engage in a conversation. You don't have to have your list of scriptures ready to validate all the claims of Jesus and all the resurrection. Just talk about their heart and how God loves them and what God did for them on the cross. And invite them to be a part of that. Anything to open that door, to have a conversation with someone about the greatest hope of the world. And if it makes you uncomfortable, you're probably doing it right. Charles Spurgeon once said, every Christian is either a missionary or an imposter. We're either a missionary or an imposter. And I think what he's getting at there is the truth that idleness and proclamation should not be a hallmark of a Christian. That is someone just as Thomas, who has known but then experienced, that experience should then spurn on into proclamation. That if we have experienced the resurrected Savior in our life, if we've experienced that transformation, we should be a people then that go and tell others. But the reality is we can't proclaim and we can't invite someone into what we haven't experienced ourselves. And so the question this morning, one of them, is the resurrection something you know of, or is the resurrection something that you have experienced? Is the resurrection something you know of? You know the story, you know the verses, you know what you do on Easter Sunday, you know he is risen indeed. You know those things, but have you experienced it in your heart? Have you experienced the tomb being opened in your soul? See, the resurrection isn't a post on the timeline of Christianity. It's the focal point of an abundant life with God. Where the crucifixion says you're covered in death, the resurrection says you're free to walk in life. The cross declares us clean. The empty tomb says, come partake in heaven, here and now, in communion and intimate relationship with your Creator, who loves you enough to take on human flesh and die for you. See, the hope of the resurrection is that we don't have to walk this life weighed down by sin, by shame, by guilt, by our circumstances, because Christ has defeated the power of darkness, defeated sin, defeated shame, defeated anxiety, defeated our doubt, our anger. And he says, come. Come and rest in my wounds. That's the hope we cling to. That's the hope that we proclaim. Because this call from John, the call from Christ, and the call for the rest of the scriptures is to be a people who invite others into the resurrection hope in its fullness and in its entirety. And if we don't experience it, if we haven't experienced it, it's going to be difficult to make that invitation. Just like I know a lot about Augusta National, you may know a lot about how we operate in the church, about what to do when we take communion, about the songs that we sing. There's a lot of things to know in here. But if that knowledge doesn't transform us, if that knowledge doesn't become experience, we're missing the object of worship, Jesus Christ. Have you heard him? Have you seen him? Have you experienced him? The invitation is open today to come, taste, and see that the Lord is good. The invitation into a step of faith, to put your fingers in his wounds and experience the trueness, the realness, the depth of his presence in your life. I don't know what's keeping you from that step of faith. Maybe it's fear, maybe it's anxiety, maybe it's saying, God, if he really knew what was going on, if I really brought that in, he wouldn't want me. I've got to clean a few things up. The scripture tells us a bruised reed he will not crush, that you are welcomed in his presence, and that by trusting in Christ, you're forgiven. We don't have to clean ourselves up to come into his presence. Maybe doubt kind of keeps you away. It's like, hey, all these stories, it's written long ago. I mean, there are other people that claim to be the Messiah. You know, the big thing in the world today is deconstructing your faith. You know, how do we know that what we have in here is true? Compared with all the other religions in the world, compared to what everybody else says, how do we know that what happened actually happened? All the disciples but one went to a gruesome death, suffering, proclaiming the hope of Christ, proclaiming the resurrection. Now, I read a little article from a gentleman who was involved in Watergate. He said, you want proof of the resurrection? Look to Watergate. Look at that cover-up. It lasted 2 weeks. Men in highest positions of power, they could only last 2 weeks, and then one by one, they started turning on each other. They started seeking to save their own skin. That a conspiracy of that magnitude, when humanity is at the forefront, when it's all about ourselves, it will crack and it will crumble. Those men each sought their own. They sought to save their own skin. But these men, the disciples, the witnesses, the martyrs of the early church, they took the gospel to the grave because they believed in something they knew, and that something they knew had transformed them by their experience with it. They had been transformed by the resurrection of Christ because God was at work and because God was transforming them by his resurrection. And just as God did that then, just as God has done it over the years, God is still doing it today. God is still at work today. God is still speaking. He is still appearing. He is still making himself known. The only question is, are you listening to him? Are you listening for him? Are you looking for him? Are you seeking to experience him? Are you sharing his name? There's two simple takeaways from what we read today. We're to believe and we're to proclaim. We can't proclaim if we don't believe. And if we believe, we must proclaim. May we be a people who cling to that resurrection hope, that belief, that abundant life is available to us in Christ Jesus through his death, through his life, through his resurrection. And may we proclaim the empty tomb to all those we come in contact with. Amen.
As we come now to a time of communion, I want to remind you that this is the table of the Lord Jesus Christ, and therefore it doesn't belong to this congregation or any particular denomination or group of Christians. As an interdenominational congregation, we believe that it belongs to Christ, and it is Christ who extends the invitation to come to you. We come to this table by the grace of God, understanding that there is no work that is necessary, for we come by God's grace alone. I invite you now to take your order of service and join with me as we read responsively our litany that's listed for you in our order of service, which this month is taken from the Lutheran tradition. Holy God, mighty God, gracious Father, endless is your mercy and eternal your reign. You have filled all creation with light and life. Heaven and earth are full of your glory. Through Abraham, you promised to bless all nations. You rescued Israel, your chosen people. Through the prophets, you renewed your promise. And at this end of all ages, you sent your Son who in words and deeds proclaimed your kingdom and was obedient to your will, even to giving his life. Therefore, we proclaim this promise. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Gracious Father, with this bread and cup, we remember the life our Lord offered up for us. And believing the witness of his resurrection, we await his coming in power to share with us the great and promised feast. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. Send now, we pray, your Holy Spirit, the Spirit of our Lord and of his resurrection, that we who receive the Lord's body and blood may live to the praise of your glory and receive our inheritance with all your saints in light. Amen. Come, Holy Spirit. Join our prayers with those of your servants of every time and every place, and unite them with the ceaseless petitions of our great high priest until he comes as victorious Lord of all. Through him, with him, in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory are yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen.
On the night of his arrest and betrayal, Christ, he sat at the table with his disciples, those who would go and share his name, and he took the bread and said, "This is my body, broken for you, take and eat." He also took the cup, and pouring it out, he said, "This is my blood shed for you, shed for the forgiveness of sins. Take and drink. As often as you gather, as often as you take of this bread and take of this cup, do this in remembrance of me."
Thank you.
body of Christ broken for you. Take and eat.
Cup of our Lord, take and drink.
I'd invite you to join me in standing as I offer this benediction over you. Now go today with confidence, knowing that that same power that raised Christ from the dead now lives in the heart of those of you who believe. Now step boldly into that faith and step boldly proclaiming that faith to all those who you come in contact with. And all God's people said, Amen. Amen.